LinkedIn. Thank you so much for your support. Also on the Alaska side, one moment that I remember is going up to Circle City, up near the 66th parallel. All you're thinking about is food. And all of a sudden, Betty and the crew come up with a fantastic spread of moose stew and great breakfast items in the morning, pancakes, bacon and eggs. So thank you so much to the crew in Circle City doing their fundraiser as well. Now at this time, not only do I want to pay attention to the volunteers, I want to make mention, special mention of the volunteers from foreign countries other than the United States and Canada. So if you don't mind, this isn't rehearsed, but please stand up if you're from a foreign country and you volunteered at the Quest this year. I don't care what kind of volunteer work you did. You might have just helped out in the back office. You might have done some paperwork. You might have been working at a checkpoint. Stand up for all of us, for people outside of North America. And we've got people like Vanessa from Scotland, Moira from New Zealand, Jean from Australia. She's also a mushroom. She comes up every year. And we've got Fintan, who I mentioned before, from Ireland. He comes out for the last 8 years helping out. These guys don't get recognition, but definitely thank you so much for coming for such a great distance to take part in the Yukon Quest. Also, we have vets and officials from all over the world as well. So many I can't mention. Over 20 states are represented in the United States, the people who have come up to support the Quest. So I want to give a special thank you, special shout-out to all those international volunteers who come here on their own dime, who pay for their own flights to be here. Thank you. We'll be bringing up the mushers in just a few moments, so we encourage you to take your seats. You'll hear from the mushers themselves, find out what it's really like to be out there on the trail. But before we talk about the Yukon Quest, something I want to highlight is the Yukon Quest 300. Now, when I joined this group and I went out to Fairbanks, I went in on all the musher meetings, and I, of course, went to the Yukon Quest meeting, and the mushers were very confident. They said, yeah, no big deal, 1,000 miles. Yeah, chop down a tree before breakfast, not a big deal. But when you meet the people from the 300, we had a lot of rookies. We went through the trail conditions, but in detail, and that's when I realized what kind of conditions these people would be facing. So we're going to pay tribute to the Yukon Quest 300 competitors here this evening. If I could have Heike come up. She's a board member from Alaska. Heike, come on up. Thank you so much for being here, and we're going to go through a few of the competitors here this evening.
Thank you very much.
Now, first of all, Heike, tell me about the 300. This is a 300-mile competition. What's involved with that?
Correct. Well, all I can say is I couldn't even mush 50 miles. So 300 miles is really tough, and this is a very tough section of the trail. And I know that the 1,000-mile is an unbelievable adventure, but 300 miles are really tough, too. And for many, this is going to be a qualifier. We've also seen the winner of the Yukon Quest 300 is the previous Rookie of the Year of the Yukon Quest. We also have a family relationship where we have the third-place winner of the Yukon Quest 300 is the daughter of the very first ever winner of the Yukon Quest 1,000-mile race. So a very, very strong relationship between our two events.
And we'll go through the list here for you. There are eight competitors. At number eight, and remember, we don't care about the position. The fact you finished is what matters, all right? But at number eight, Jimmy LeBling. In seventh place, Blake Matray. Cindy Abbott at number six. Ed Abramson, number five.
And here comes a finisher from Brazil.
I hope I pronounced your name properly. Luan Marquez. And can I say the daughter of Sonny? Is that the...
Yes,
Ava Linder. Ava Linder, number three. In second place, Rob Cook.
Rob Cook is also of the Yukon, so here's to Rob.
And number one in the Yukon Quest 300, Josh Kadza.
We had a wonderful Yukon Quest 300 this year, and I want to thank everybody who participated, the mushers that ran it, the handers that supported it. It's tough running a 300-mile race while the 1,000 guys are getting all the attention. So we really, really appreciate everything that they've done. I also want to thank Doug Grillo, who can't be here today. He's unfortunately in China. He's one of my fellow board members and was the race marshal for the Yukon Quest 300. Alex Olson and other fellow board members and vice president of the Alaska board, who was absolutely vital to the success of the YQ 300. And then Maria Frog Roberts, our Quest baby, yeah, who has grown up living, breathing the Quest and is one of our amazing staff members. So thank you for making the Yukon Quest 300 happen. Great job.
All right. And up and down that trail, 1,000 miles, you get blurry-eyed, you start to see things in the dark, and all of a sudden you realize, no, what am I, is that an illusion? No, it's Hans Otley. Hans, come on up. Hans will come up here to say a few words along with Kathleen McGill, Dr. McGill, the head vet, and we're going to go through the mushers and basically bring them up here to listen to the crowd.
Good evening. I would like to extend some personal thank you in a hurry. I know we had a lot of thank yous tonight, but for me, as trying to run this race, it is very important that we have good people out there. And I first and foremost would like to thank Kathleen McGill, our head veterinarian, and their team for an incredible work and always there when we needed them. And a good relationship. It was really a pleasure to work with them. Also, Josh Forst, our trail manager, sorry, race manager, and his team that pulled everything together this year that we needed. And sometimes he didn't have it in place. It didn't matter. It was there when we needed it. Also, our executive directors on both sides, their staff, the board members on both sides. It takes a lot of people to put on a race like this. In my estimation, we have about 1,000 volunteers. That makes 42 volunteers per musher. I think that's quite incredible. I would also like to thank the media and the photographers. It's always kind of an interesting thing. They have a job to do, and sometimes they overdo it a little bit, you know. And they actually never got in our way. I think it was perfect. They stuck to what we asked them to do, and it was a good relationship, and I hope it continues like that. We need them. We need the stories, and we need the pictures. From all the volunteers get a lot of thank you, and it's pretty well impossible for me to name them all. So this year I decided that I would like to thank one for all, and I hope she will stand up. It's a volunteer that's been coming back year after year. She runs the circuit checkpoint flawlessly. Nothing I have to worry. That lady, she comes to Whitehorse on an airplane from Australia. She then takes an airplane down to Seattle, flies to Anchorage, flies to Fairbanks, takes a ride out to Circle City to be our checker on her own money. And if that isn't enough, she takes a flight back from Fairbanks to Seattle, to Vancouver, to Whitehorse, takes a ride to CarMax, does it all over again. And I'd like you to welcome from Australia, Jean Egerton. Please stand up. You deserve it. I would like you to introduce my own team. I was a very lucky guy this year. I had an incredible team I trust my judges 100%. They represent me when I'm not there, and I never question their judgment. They are just an outstanding crew. From Fairbanks, Alaska, Patty Imus, please stand. From Cedar Lake, Montana, Donna Miller. From Dawson City, Yukon, Shelly Byrne. From Whitehorse, Yukon, Kyra Adams. The boys, the majority of women this year. The boys from Plains Junction, Yukon, Reinhard Semmel. I'm from Prospect, Oregon, and you never find this town on the map. Terry Hinesley. Thank you very much for being part of my team.
Thank you, Hans. Hans is a race marshal. At this time, I'd like to bring up Dr. Kathleen McGill, the head vet.
Thank you. Good evening. It's good to be back. I took a break for a year, and it's now nice to be back and see a lot of familiar faces and friends and their families. First, I'd like to send a good shout-out to the vet team. They've been great this year. I could send them any place. They do anything. They volunteer for extra duty. A great group to work with. So as I call your name, just remain standing, and then we can applaud for all of them at the end. Some have already left for home, so I'll just say their name and where they're from, but the few that are here. Dr. Mercedes Pinto, Fairbanks. Dr. Chris Christensen, our pathologist from Washington, D.C. Dr. John Overall from Dawson. Dr. Janine Licardi from Washington State's already flown home. Dr. Catherine Van Dyne from Anchorage. Dr. Greg Phillips, Minnesota. Dr. Marcus Barth, Alberta, he's gone home. Dr. Christina Hansen has already gone home, Fairbanks. Dr. Jess Heath, Whitehorse. And then we have three vets that have come a long way. The next two from Norway. Dr. Per Erik Hem from Norway. Dr. Hanna Fredriksen from Norway, and she's going home to be the head vet for the Finnmark Slopet. And last but not least, Dr. David Moroni from Australia. We also have two vet assistants, Bill Nanick and Donna Russell Swope, that the vet team couldn't do without. Dennis, I'm sorry, Dennis Griffin, Wisconsin. I thought I had everybody written down. Dennis is new to us this year, but he's done a lot of Iditarods, and I met Dennis years ago on the Iditarod in Ruby. We were kind of stuck in Ruby for a while. I'm sorry, Dennis. One thing I do want to do for the vet team, we're always, pilots and everybody complain about all the gear we have, which we do. We have vet boxes, our own personal medical kit, and then our coats and our boots and our duffel bags and our sleeping bags. And so everybody complains about the gear the vets take down the trail. This year, I want to point out one of the vets who had the smallest duffel bag ever for a vet team, and that was Dr. Dave Moroni. So let's clap for him. Also, I want to say thanks to the judges. It's been a pleasure always to work with Hans. We have a really good working relationship. I feel I can go to him with any problems. He comes to me, keeps me in the loop. And all the judges, we felt very comfortable working with all the judges. It's been a great group. And Josh taught me how to read a spreadsheet. So Josh Horst gets my vote. 21 pages of spreadsheet on my wall at home, and I finally learned how to do logistics, I think, this year from Josh. So thanks a lot, and I'll turn it back over to the MC.
Exactly. Before you run, I just want to mention one thing. Along the trail, you see a lot of strange things. One thing that burns in my memory is Kathleen trying to take a break, so she goes to the vehicle. She said, give me 2 hours. Within 2 minutes, you hear this on the window. Kathleen, we need you. And so thanks to Kathleen. She definitely had maybe an hour and a half of sleep the whole time. So definitely thank you so much for your commitment as well. And now we get to call upon our famous mushers. Some of them love to speak, some don't. We're not going to put too much pressure on you, but really, everyone would love to hear what you have to say about your experiences on the trail. We're going to start off with our first fella. I remember at the very beginning in Fairbanks, we were looking for him, and unfortunately he withdrew, but his name is Kurt Reich from, of course, his bib number 8, sponsored by EBA Engineering Consultants. Thank you, Kurt. Wish you could be here, but we do understand how things happen sometimes. Secondly, scratched, Nicolet Etienne, bib number 14, Tate's Custom Trailers. Thank you so much, Nicolet, or Nikolai, that should be. Marin Bradley, local girl, sponsored by Infinite's Restaurant, bib number 23. Marin, thank you so much, all the way up the circle, and that's not an easy trek at all, but hey, there's always next year. Jason Witzel as well, Irving Collision Repairs, bib number 9. And Mike Ellis, we heard the story, he was out there trucking along, and boom, some things happen on the trail that you regret, but what can you do? Bib number 18, Builder's Supply Land. Mike Ellis, we hope you're feeling better and you don't feel the pain. Definitely, with a separated shoulder, you really got to see what it's like to be on the trail. Still on the trail this evening, and if you've been following along on the tracker, you might know of a fella, number 19, or make that number 24, bib number 24, sponsored by Whitehorse Motors from Siberia, Russia. His name is Michael Telpin. And at this point, we haven't last heard. He hasn't hit Braeburn yet, has he? He's in Braeburn? Okay, so he'll be coming to the Braeburn real soon. We're hoping to wish him well when he comes across the line in the near future. Also, bib number 15, brought to you by Max Fireweed Bookstore. Marcel Fresneau. She's still on the trail. So we have two out there. Let's hear it for them. When you say the word perseverance, think of those two people. Definitely, they've got the heart. And now we're going to go to bib number 5, brought to you by Quest Engineering Group. And she came in 17th place. Let's hear it for Misha Peterson. Misha, coming up.
I'm so happy that I'm here. I almost ended my race in the... when I was going over the Eagle Summit, I lost one of my dogs, and I was... That time, if the dog don't would be fine, I would have to be out of the race. And I was very happy that Ed Abrahamson found the dog and put it in his team, and bring it to the next checkpoint, and that's why I could be here. And then I would like to thank him, and I would like to thank all the volunteers and vets who was on the trail, because they was always so nice, and was very fun travel between the checkpoints and meet all those people. And I would like to thank the people who left me around their dogs. So this summer I really want to do the quest, but I don't have dogs and I don't have money to leave the team. And then I put an ad in the Sea Dog Central that I would like to have dogs for the quest. And Jim and Bonnie Foster, they offered me their dogs, and they not just let me run their dogs, but they sponsor me too, and I would like to say big thanks to them. And my other dog was from Leslie Morrison, and I have another few dogs from Molly McCarthy, one of my dogs from Mike Supranas. I have just dogs from all over, and I was very happy to train them, put them together, and I'm happy that I'm here. And thank you, everyone.
And in 16th place, boy, he had quite the fanfare coming in late in the evening. Brian Wilmhurst from Dawson City. Brian, come on down. Bib number 11, brought to you by the Eldorado Hotel. And I just want to say hello, a special shout-out to all the Dawson people, all the Dawson volunteers, Gabby and the crew, and all those people that put in tireless hours setting up. Thank you so much for Dawson and the entire group up there. He's getting the cat calls already.
Thanks. I'm glad to be here. There's certainly points that I think I wasn't going to make it to the end or make it to the banquet at least, but I'm here and super excited. I got to thank a bunch of people, of course. My dogs, because they haul my fat butt around all winter. And, of course, my lovely wife, Melissa. I always forget to thank her, but this time I got her, so thank you very much. The vets, it was awesome working with them and learning so much, and they always had time to come look at your dogs right away and stuff like that. That was cool. Especially John Overall, you know, he taught me everything I know. You know, volunteers, nice people, everywhere we went, there's super nice people to feed you and then wake you up and then feed you some more. So everyone was awesome. My handlers, Mark and Steph, they're great, especially in Dawson. I'm kind of worried that my handlers get too drunk and too rowdy and not be able to put up a tent for my dogs and stuff like that. But I got there and it looked all professional and stuff like that. We looked good. Stayed with some great people, the Gallegos, I think was their last name, something like that, and Jeff Fairbanks. You know, they just emailed me and stayed with them, and they were super nice. Everyone in Dawson, the community of Dawson was awesome. You know, everyone got behind me and really helped me. And Sebastian Schnuli, too, he helped me with some great tips and really helped me get to the finish line. Sponsors are Skookum Brand. They gave me a nice parka I barely wore because it was so warm. Napa Auto Parts in Dawson. Frank Turner and Red Paw there. Muck Talk, they gave me some dog food, which is great. Schmidt Mining, the Westmark Hotel, Bonanza Market, Fishville Charters, and Chautauqua Bakery. They give me money so I can say the name, so thank you.
Thank you, Brian. And you know, it really doesn't matter what place you come in, because at the end of the day, you finish the race. And you hear about that all the time, but it's never really apparent until this lady came across the finish line. And, wow, quite the crowd was there for her, and it was great to see that support. She's been out there a few times. This is her first time where she actually finished, so she's no longer a rookie. Her name, Yuka Honda. Yuka, come on up. And one of those behind-the-scenes moments, it was interesting during the interview, someone asked her, when did you know you'd finished the race? And she said, at the beginning. So here she is now. We have a vet here, luckily, so everything's okay. Yuka, come on up.
Hi, I'm Yuka Honda. I'm glad I'm here, so I have a quest. Yeah, nice people, like everybody so nice, sponsor, vet, volunteer, official, everybody, Marcia also, quest people. I love Chris people and I love beer, so I'm glad. So thank you very much. And I want to say thank you to my handler, Yoshi and Debbie and Erin. Thank you very much. And I want to say my story. I don't know, my English is not good, so if you have a question, please ask me later. So. I want to thank my late friend, Shuko. She was like my Asuka mother, always taking care of me and supporting me in many ways so I could race in the Yukon Quest. She Chico died from cancer last June, so she wasn't able to see me finally finish, but I know her spirit was with me on the trail. So thank you, Mr. Machiko-san. I did it. Banzai!
Thank you, Yuka. Hi, kids. Thank you so much for your support. Also on the Alaska side, one moment that I remember is going up to Circle City, up near the 66th parallel. All you're thinking about is food. And all of a sudden, Benny and the crew come up with a fantastic spread of moose stew and great breakfast items in the morning, pancakes, bacon and eggs. So thank you so much to the crew in Circle City doing their fundraiser as well. Now at this time, not only do I want to pay attention to the volunteers, I want to make mention, special mention of the volunteers from foreign countries other than the United States and Canada. So if you don't mind, this isn't rehearsed, but please stand up if you're from a foreign country and you volunteered at the Quest this year. I don't care what kind of volunteer work you did. You might have just helped out in the back office. You might have done some paperwork. You might have been working at a checkpoint. Stand up for all of us, for people outside of North America. And we've got people like Vanessa from Scotland, Moira from New Zealand, Jean from Australia. She's also a musher. She comes up every year. And we've got Fintan, who I mentioned before, from Ireland. He comes out for the last 8 years helping out. These guys don't get recognition, but definitely thank you so much for coming for such a great distance to take part in the Yukon Quest. Also, we have vets and officials from all over the world as well. So many I can't mention. Over 20 states are represented in the United States, the people who have come up to support the Quest. So I want to give a special thank you, special shout-out to all those international volunteers who come here on their own dime, who pay for their own flights to be here. Thank you. We'll be bringing up the mushers in just a few moments, so we encourage you to take your seats. You'll hear from the mushers themselves, find out what it's really like to be out there on the trail. But before we talk about the Yukon Quest, something I want to highlight is the Yukon Quest 300. Now, when I joined this group and I went out to Fairbanks, I went in on all the musher meetings, and I, of course, went to the Yukon Quest meeting, and the mushers were very confident. They said, yeah, no big deal, 1,000 miles. Yeah, chop down a tree before breakfast, not a big deal. But when you meet people from the 300, we had a lot of rookies. We went through the trail conditions but in detail, and that's when I realized what kind of conditions these people would be facing. So we're going to pay tribute to the Yukon Quest 300 competitors here this evening. If I could have Heike come up. She's a board member from Alaska. Heike, come on up. Thank you so much for being here, and we're going to go through a few of the competitors here this evening.
Thank you very much.
Now, first of all, Heike, tell me about the 300. This is a 300-mile competition. What's involved with that?
Correct. Well, all I can say is I couldn't even mush 50 miles. So 300 miles is really tough, and this is a very tough section of the trail. And I know that the 1,000-mile is an unbelievable adventure, but 300 miles are really tough, too. And for many, this is going to be a qualifier. We've also seen the winner of the Yukon Quest 300 is the previous Rookie of the Year of the Yukon Quest. We also have a family relationship where we have the third place winner of the Yukon Quest 300 is the daughter of the very first ever winner of the Yukon Quest 1,000-mile race. So a very, very strong relationship between our two events.
And we'll go through the list here for you. There are eight competitors. At number eight, and remember, we don't care about the position. The fact you finished is what matters, all right? But at number eight, Jimmy LeBling. In seventh place, Blake Matre. Cindy Abbott at number six. Ed Abramson, number five.
And here comes the finisher from Brazil.
I hope I pronounced your name properly. Luan Marquez. And can I say the daughter of Sunny? Is that the...
Yes,
Ava Linder. Ava Linder, number three. In second place, Rob Cook.
Rob Cook is also of the Yukon. So here's to Rob.
And number one in the Yukon Quest 300, Josh Tazzo.
We had a wonderful Yukon Quest 300 this year, and I want to thank everybody who participated, the mushers that ran it, the handers that supported it. It's tough running a 300-mile race while the 1,000 guys are getting all the attention. So we really, really appreciate everything that they've done. I also want to thank Doug Grillo, who can't be here today. He's unfortunately in China. He's one of my fellow board members and was the race marshal for the Yukon Quest 300. Alex Olson and other fellow board members and vice president of the Alaska board, who was absolutely vital to the success of the YQ 300. And then Maria Frog Roberts, our quest baby, yeah, who has grown up living, breathing the quest and is one of our amazing staff members. So thank you for making the Yukon Quest 300 happen. Great job.
All right. And up and down that trail, 1,000 miles, you get blurry-eyed, you start to see things in the dark, and all of a sudden you realize, no, what am I, is that an illusion? No, it's Hans Otley. Hans, come on up. Hans will come up here to say a few words, along with Kathleen McGill, Dr. McGill, the head vet, and we're going to go through the mushers and basically bring them up here, introduce them to the crowd.
Good evening. I would like to extend some personal thank you in a hurry. I know we had a lot of thank yous tonight, but for me, as trying to run this race, it is very important that we have good people out there. And I first and foremost would like to thank Kathleen McGill, our head veterinarian, and their team for an incredible work and always there when we needed them. And a good relationship. It was really a pleasure to work with them. Also, Josh Forst, our race manager, and his team that put everything together this year that we needed. And sometimes we didn't have it in place. It didn't matter. It was there when we needed it. Also, our executive directors on both sides, their staff, the board members on both sides. It takes a lot of people to put on a race like this. In my estimation, we have about 1,000 volunteers. That makes 42 volunteers per musher. I think that's quite incredible. I would also like to thank the media and the photographers. It's always kind of an interesting thing. They have a job to do, and sometimes they overdo it a little bit, you know. They actually never got in our way. I think it was perfect. They stuck to what we asked them to do, and it was a good relationship, and I hope it continues like that. We need them. We need the stories, and we need the pictures. From all the volunteers get a lot of thank you, and it's pretty well impossible for me to name them all. So this year I decided that I would like to thank one for all, and I hope she will stand up. It's a volunteer that's been coming back year after year. She runs the certain checkpoints flawlessly. Nothing I have to worry. That lady, she comes to Whitehorse on an airplane from Australia. She then takes an airplane down to Seattle, flies to Anchorage, flies to Fairbanks, takes a ride out to Circle City to pay our checker on her own money. Now, if that isn't enough, she takes a flight back from Fairbanks to Seattle, to Vancouver, to Whitehorse, takes a ride to CarMax, does it all over again. And I'd like you to welcome from Australia, Jean Egerton. Please stand up. You deserve it. I also like you to introduce my own team. I was a very lucky guy this year. I had an incredible team. I trust my judges 100%. They represent me when I'm not there, and I never question their judgment. They're just an outstanding crew. From Fairbanks, Alaska, Patty Imus, please stand. From Cedar Lake, Montana, Donna Miller. From Dawson City, Yukon, Shelly Brown. From Whitehorse, Yukon, Tyra Adams. The boys, we're the majority of women this year. The boys from Haines Junction, Yukon, Reinhard Semmel. And from Prospect, Oregon, and you never find this town on the map, Terry Hensley. Thank you very much for being part of my team.
Thank you, Hans. Hans is a race marshal. At this time, I'd like to bring up Dr. Kathleen McGill, the head vet.
Thank you. Good evening. It's good to be back. I took a break for a year, and it's now nice to be back and see a lot of familiar faces and friends and their families. First, I'd like to send a good shout-out to the vet team. They've been great this year. I could send them any place. They do anything. They volunteer for extra duty. A great group to work with. So as I call your name, just remain standing, and then we can applaud for all of them at the end. Some have already left for home, so I'll just say their name and where they're from, but the few that are here. Dr. Mercedes Pinto, Fairbanks. Dr. Chris Christensen, our pathologist from Washington, D.C. Dr. John Overall from Dawson. Dr. Janine Licardi from Washington State, already flown home. Dr. Catherine Van Dyne from Anchorage. Dr. Greg Phillips, Minnesota. Dr. Marcus Barth, Alberta, he's gone home. Dr. Christina Hansen has already gone home, Fairbanks. Dr. Jess Heath, Whitehorse. And then we have three vets that have come a long way. The next two from Norway, Dr. Per Erik Hem from Norway, Dr. Hanna Fredriksen from Norway, and she's going home to be the head vet for the Finnmark Slopet. And last but not least, Dr. David Maroney from Australia. We also have two vet assistants, Bill Nanick and Donna Russell Swope, that the vet team couldn't do without. Dennis, I'm sorry, Dennis Griffin, Wisconsin. I thought I had everybody written down. Dennis is new to us this year, but he's done a lot of Iditarods, and I met Dennis years ago on the Iditarod and Ruby. We were kind of stuck in Ruby for a while. I'm sorry, Dennis. One thing I do want to do for the vet team, we're always, pilots and everybody complain about all the gear we have, which we do. We have vet boxes, our own personal medical kit, and then our coats and our boots and our duffel bags and our sleeping bags. And so everybody complains about the gear the vets take down the trail. This year, I want to point out one of the vets who had the smallest duffel bag ever for a vet team, and that was Dr. Dave Maroney. So let's clap for him. Also, I want to say thanks to the judges. It's been a pleasure always to work with Hans. We have a really good working relationship. I feel I can go to him with any problems. He comes to me, keeps me in the loop. And all the judges, we felt very comfortable working with all the judges. It's been a great group. And Josh taught me how to read a spreadsheet. So Josh Horst gets my vote. 21 pages of spreadsheet on my wall at home, and I finally learned how to do logistics, I think, this year from Josh. So thanks a lot, and I'll turn it back over to the MC.
And Kathleen, before you run, I just want to mention one thing. Along the trail, you see a lot of strange things. One thing that burns in my memory is Kathleen trying to take a break. So she goes to the vehicle. She said, give me 2 hours. Within 2 minutes, you hear this on the window. Kathleen, we need you. And so thanks to Kathleen. She definitely had maybe an hour and a half of sleep the whole time. So definitely thank you so much for your commitment as well. And now we get to call upon our famous mushers. Some of them love to speak, some don't. We're not going to put too much pressure on you, but really, everyone would love to hear what you have to say about your experiences on the trail. We're going to start off with our first fella. I remember at the very beginning in Fairbanks, we were looking for him, and unfortunately he withdrew. But his name is Kurt Reich from, of course, his bib number 8, sponsored by EBA Engineering Consultants. Thank you, Kurt. Wish you could be here, but we do understand how things happen sometimes. Secondly, scratched, Nicolay Etienne. Bib number 14, Tate's Custom Trailers. Thank you so much, Nicolay, or Nikolai, that should be. Marin Bradley, local girl, sponsored by Antoinette's Restaurant, bib number 23. Marin, thank you so much, all the way up the circle, and that's not an easy trek at all, but hey, there's always next year. Jason Witzel as well, Irving Collision Repairs, bib number 9. And Mike Ellis, we heard the story, he was out there trucking along, and boom, some things happen on the trail that you regret, but what can you do? Bib number 18, Builder Supply Land. Mike Ellis, we hope you're feeling better and you don't feel the pain. Definitely, with a separated shoulder, you really got to see what it's like to be on the trail. Still on the trail this evening, and if you've been following along on the tracker, you might know of a fella, number 19, or make that number 24, bib number 24, sponsored by Whitehorse Motors from Siberia, Russia. His name is Michael Telpin. And at this point, we haven't last heard. He hasn't hit Braeburn yet, has he? We haven't. He's in Braeburn? Okay, so he'll be coming to the Braeburn real soon. We're hoping to wish him well when he comes across the line in the near future. Also, bib number 15, brought to you by Max Fireweed Bookstore. Marcel Fresneau. She's still on the trail. So we have two out there. Let's hear it for them. When you say the word perseverance, think of those two people. Definitely, they've got the heart. And now we're going to go to bib number 5, brought to you by Quest Engineering Group. And she came in 17th place. Let's hear it for Misha Peterson. Misha, coming up.
I'm so happy that I'm here. I almost ended my race in the... when I was going over the Eagle Summit, I lost one of my dogs, and I was... That time, if the dog don't would be fine, I would have to be out of the race. And I was very happy that Ed Abrahamson found the dog and put it in his team, and bring it to the next checkpoint, and that's why I could be here. And then I would like to thank him, and I would like to thank all the volunteers and vets who was on the trail, because they was always so nice, and was very fun travel between the checkpoints and meet all those people. And I would like to thank the people who let me run their dogs. So this summer I really want to do the quest, but I don't have dogs and I don't have money to lease the team. And then I put an ad in the Sedox Central that I would like to have dogs for the quest. And Jim and Bonnie Fosters, they offer me their dogs, and they not just let me run their dogs, but they sponsor me too, and I would like to say big thanks to them. And my other dog was from Leslie Morrison, and I have another few dogs from Molly McCarthy, one of my dogs from Mike Supranath. I have just dogs from all over, and I was very happy to train them and put them together, and I'm happy that I'm here. And thank you, everyone.
And in 16th place, boy, he had quite the fanfare coming in late in the evening. Brian Wilmshurst from Dawson City. Brian, come on down. Bib number 11, brought to you by the Eldorado Hotel. And I just want to say hello, a special shout out to all the Dawson people, all the Dawson volunteers, Gabby and the crew, and all those people that put in the tireless hours setting up. Thank you so much for Dawson and the entire group up there. He's getting the cat calls already.
Thanks. I'm glad to be here. There's certainly points that I think I wasn't going to make it to the end or make it to the banquet at least, but I'm here and super excited. I got to thank a bunch of people, of course. My dogs, because they haul my fat butt around all winter. And, of course, my lovely wife, Melissa. I always forget to thank her, but this time I got her, so thank you very much. The vets, it was awesome working with them and learning so much, and they always had time to come, we'll get your dogs right away and stuff like that, and that was cool. Especially John Overall, you know, he's taught me everything I know. You know, volunteers, nice people, everywhere we went, there's super nice people to feed you and then wake you up and then feed you some more. So everyone was awesome. My handlers, Mark and Steph, they're great, especially in Dawson. I'm kind of worried that my handlers get too drunk and too rowdy and not be able to put up a tent for my dogs and stuff like that. But I got there and it looked all professional and stuff like that. We looked good. Stayed with some great people, the Gallegos, I think was the last name, something like that, in Fairbanks. You know, they just emailed me and stayed with them and they were super nice. Everyone in Dawson, the community of Dawson was awesome. You know, everyone got behind me and really helped me. And Sebastian Schmuley, too, he helped me with some great tips and really helped me get to the finish line. Sponsors are Skookum Brand. They gave me a nice parka I barely wore because it was so warm. Napa Auto Parts in Dawson. Frank Turner and Red Paw there. Muck Talk, they gave me some dog food, which is great. Schmidt Mining, the Westmark Hotel, Bonanza Market, Fishville Charters, and Chautauqua Bakery. They give me money so I can say their names, so thank you.
Thank you, Brian. And, you know, it really doesn't matter what place you come in because at the end of the day, you finish the race. And you hear about that all the time, but it's never really apparent until this lady came across the finish line. And, wow, quite the crowd was there for her. And it was great to see that support. She's been out there a few times. This is her first time where she actually finished, so she's no longer a rookie. Her name, Yuka Honda. Yuka, come on up. And one of those behind-the-scenes moments is interesting. During the interview, someone asked her, when did you know you'd finished the race? And she said, at the beginning. So here she is now. We have a vet here, luckily, so everything's okay. You can come on up.
Hi, I'm Yuka Honda. I'm glad I'm here, so I have a quest. Yeah, nice people, like everybody so nice, sponsor, vet, volunteer, official, everybody, master also, quest people. I love Chris people, and I love beer, so I'm glad. So thank you very much. And I want to say thank you to my handler, Yoshi, and Debbie, and Erin. Thank you very much. And I want to say my story. I don't know, my English is not good, so if you have a question, please ask me later. So. I want to thank my late friend Shuko. She was like my Alaska mother, always taking care of me and supporting me in many ways. So I could live in the Yukon Crest. She could died from cancer last June. So she wasn't able to see me finally finish. But I know her spirit was with me on the trail. So thank you, Ms. Yamatsuko-san. I did it. Banzai!
Thank you, Yuka. 14th place, bib number 12, sponsored by Latitude Wireless. Same thing with Yuka Honda, sponsored by Latitude. Thank you so much, Latitude Wireless and Northwest Hell, for sponsoring two bibs this evening. Number 14, Paige Drobny. Paige, come on up.
This might be the hardest part of the whole race, actually. Being up here, I can't even see faces right now. There's so many lights. I guess a lot of people are wondering what it's like out on the trail, and this is my rookie year, and things definitely changed as you moved down the trail. As you know, there's like markers along the trail that guide the way for us, and when there's a hazard, there's a big X in the trail. And on the Alaska side, when you see an X, you know that the shit's about to hit the fan. And you brace yourself and hold on and just hope that you're going to make it through it. And I started to get a little bit of anxiety seeing X's because there's so many of them and there were so many hazards in the trail. And but we made it through it. And the interesting thing is that once you cross the border, you see X's. And I would see an X and I would go, start to get really nervous. And next thing I would know, I don't know if I fell asleep through it or what happened, but there was nothing really that terrible with the X's on the Canadian side. So there would be a little bump in the trail or like a slight turn, and there would be an X there letting us know. So the trail definitely gets better on this side. There's a lot more hazards on the Alaskan side. So I did lose my anxiety for the X's as the trail went on. But there's a lot of people I need to thank, primarily my dogs. I was continually amazed by what they could do, getting me down the trail and being happy and wagging and smiling all the time. It's what it's all about, really, is watching those guys smile and do what they love to do. I really need to thank my handlers. They did an amazing job. Cody, my husband, and Thomas Robertson and Emily Bernhard. They were just amazing, and Dawson, and all along the way. I truly thank you for all of that help. And I heard these guys say that for every musher, there's 42 volunteers, but and that's just during the race. And if you think about, I think about how much help that I had before the race. And the number is huge, and it's mind-boggling and overwhelming and emotional when I think about how many people helped me. And I can't thank them all enough for all my friends in Esther and Fairbanks who helped pack bags, cut meat, doing sewing foxtails, leggings. It's just really overwhelming. A special thanks goes to my friend and vet, Tamara Rose. I had several injuries in early December, and I didn't know if I would actually make it here, and she came over on Christmas night, actually, and looked over all my dogs and told me that they were all fine and I was going to be okay. A special thanks to you, to Jenna and Rick Asilo. They're at home right now watching the dogs that we left at home and taking great care of them, and really appreciate that. And also to the vets on the race, I learned more in the last 2 weeks than I have in my 6 years of mushing, and it's stuff that you just can't learn other than when you're actually out there on the race doing this. So I'm definitely a better musher now than I was 2 weeks ago, and that's really exciting. And also to all the volunteers on the trail, there's smiling faces everywhere you go and people cheering you on, and and coming, you know, even through Dawson, there was construction workers popping their heads out of buildings and going, you know, yay, we're so proud of you. And it was really awesome. Food everywhere, happy faces. Like Brian said, people waking you up, feeding you, wanting to feed you again and again and again. And we eat a lot out there. So that's really nice. And then to also a couple more sponsors, Scurrying my headlamp. That thing lights the trail up, and I can see for a long ways, and I loved it. UBS is a bank that sponsored us, and we appreciate their support. Dog Paddle Designs, my sled was amazing. Everything I could hope for in a sled. And last but not least, my parents. They are huge supporters of me and my crazy adventures, and they were happy to support our kennel in this last adventure. They considered it a college fund for the dogs. So they're excited that seven of the dogs graduated college this week. So so thank you. I appreciate it. And hopefully we'll be back again. Thanks.
Thank you, Paige. And bib number 20 is brought to you by Ajax Steel and Industrial Supply. Came in 13th place, Gus Gunther. Gus, come on up.
I just want to say I think the last 14 days have been pretty much what it's all about. Thank you very much.
That's awesome. Thank you. Let's hear it for Gus.
Yes.
Tip number 22, brought to you by the Facebook fans. Boy, we had a ton of those fans out. Thank you so much for following along on Facebook. Number 22 was the bib number. He came in 12th place. Trent Herbst. Trent.
I got a ton of people to thank, but I'm not going to go through that list because they know who they were. On top of the list, I got to say, running with John Little's Lines of Dogs, it has been a treat for the last couple of years, and I got to thank Jake and Robin for all their support. It's been a blast helping out the kennel, and all the helpers in the kennel. It's been a phenomenal 2 years. Now, that's our selfish part. You know, this is a pretty selfish sport from the fact that we get to run and play with our dogs pretty much the whole winter and summer. And then we're on the trail with all of the volunteers and vets and people who have been doing this race for so many years. And it's quite an honor to be able to go down the trail. This is my first time down it. It's been a dream of mine to go down this trail for a number of years. And I got to quit my teaching job to do this, which is fantastic. It feels good to quit a teaching job and be able to go run the Yukon Quest. So I do miss the students, and I consider my dogs as very similar to my own to teaching students. And you know, going through the checkpoints and seeing the other people see that also, it's kind of heartwarming. And I got to tell you that all the people that are out there have been doing this for year after year after year. It is really amazing for us as dog drivers to see that. You see you guys keep coming back year after year after year and hearing the stories. And I hear Wayne Hall and his wife out in Eagle, their story of chopping the ice for 3 days with their Pulaskis for a 1 mile section of trail. That's only 1 mile out of 1,000 miles, and they spent 3 days so that we could have a smooth trail coming into Eagle. And that's only one small story about the entire trail, and that's incredibly humbling. So thanks for all of you that come out and help us run our dogs down the trail so that we can selfishly have a good time.
And bib number 7 is brought to you by Super Save Propane and Fencing. She's going to be a superstar real soon, not just in mushing, but also on television. Because she was followed by Ice Road Truckers. Ice Road Truckers, a TV show, got a hold of her, and her name is Kyla Durham. She's in 11th place. Kyla, come on up. And the fashion is brought to you by the Yukon Quest.
Oh, God.
glad. Well, where to start? Glad to be here again. I should start with thanking Brent for thinking I did a good job with his puppies last year and having me do it again. I'd say these ones are even better than last year. I had a yearling team, and they were amazing, truly amazing. They blew my mind every turn. My last run, I had this dog, Sound, the youngest dog on my team. Most of the young dogs, when you get partway into the race, a couple hundred miles, a lot of them don't want to lead quite as much. This is the youngest dog on my team, second race she's ever run in her life. She led half the way here from Braeburn. It was amazing. She's my little hero. I'd like to thank my handlers, Mandy and Matt. They did great. It was fun seeing you guys at all the places. And everyone else who helped out in Dawson, Mike Ellis, Christine, Tom, you know, I feel like there's just so many people in Dawson that turned up and they was like, go away, come back in 36 hours, we got it. And I was like, okay, go to sleep. My parents, they've been very supportive, not freaked out too much. They try not to, you know, pester me with too many emails of like, oh my God, you're still alive, and help financially a little. And the dog sponsors on our Wild and Free site, I'd like to thank them a lot for helping out with all sponsoring all of our little doggies. The vets, I had a really good time with a lot of the vets this year. they helped out a lot. I learned a lot about, you know, dog care after last year and this year. I feel like I've learned a lot from them. The volunteers are great, especially a lot of the hospitality stops. They just take such good care of you. It's crazy. They just, can we give you food? You just sleep. Can we wake you up? I'm like, oh, I'm like, okay. I think that's about it. I probably forgot something important, but yeah, glad to be here.
And in 10th place, and his bib is number 4, brought to you by Canada's Best Value Inn. Please welcome Dave Dalton. Dave.
Hello, how's everybody doing out there? Did we give you a great race again? 26 seconds. No? That wasn't good enough for you guys? Come on. I know Hugh since 98 when I first met him on the Minto 90. He's just a young kid driving Lester Earhart's team from Canada. And I asked him, where'd you get those dogs? And I know this guy in the village just gave me a bunch of dogs to try out. I don't think they're very good, but he wants some miles put on, so I entered this race. And a guy from Chicago just followed me around like there's no tomorrow. I said, this guy is crazy. And then I met him again a couple of years ago on the Quest, and I went by a couple of guys he was traveling with, and I went a couple more hours, and I stopped. I'm going to, you know, hey, Dave, I'm going to travel with you for a little bit. Okay. And I said, well, I'm just going to go a couple hours and stop and rest. Okay. He goes, all right, fine. And I stopped, and he's just milling around for about 15 minutes. I said, well, I'm going to go again and catch the other guy ahead of me. I go, this guy's going to burn his dogs out. And sure enough, he kind of fizzled that year. But he kept on going year after year after year, and he won this great race. Congratulations, Hugh. And then for Alan. Alan, I'm going to give you the, come on, man. You had a penalty, plus you had a dog in the basket. I'm going to give you that, come on, man. Next time, you'll beat his ass. He'll have that drive on him. He'll know. Hugh knows. He did the same thing a couple years ago. He knows how to get those guys going and then push all they got to win that race. When you're that close, Alan, you'll get that feeling back, and you put it back in your head there and just thrive them. Another thing I'd like to thank is Kathleen, the head vet. I mean, on her watch, there's no dogs that die in this race. Her crew, she organizes this crew so well that she better set up something that the Quest can follow for years, because she does a great job every time she comes up here. And that's what we need, a race with no dogs dying. It's great for the sport. Congratulations to the vets and the crew. They did a really good job this year. And then the trail crew. We bitched and moaned last year, and you came through this year, and it was a great trail. Well marked, groomed, the best trail I've seen in about 22 years. And then all the checkpoints were great. We knew where everything was, where the water was, how the trail conditions were. Everything was great. Another great job. Talking to Frank Turner a little bit ago, he says he's coming out of retirement because his race was so easy this year. So we're going to get him out racing. Next year is going to be the 30th anniversary of the Yukon Quest. We have to think outside the box and do something different. We need to get a bigger purse so mushers can support themselves to come year after year and race this race. So we need to work with our boards. The mushers need to work together, and we need to have a bond, a real good bond for next year's race, the 30th, and get a little bit more money up and get this organization going in the right direction, and just think outside the box, come up with some new ideas, and get this race on the right track for the next 30 years. There's a lot of gold out there these days, and these guys are making some money, so that's a good place to start. It's good for the community to know that the people that are getting gold and refining the minerals around the area, that they're supporting the locals and helping out and supporting racing in the communities. So we need to get out of the offices and start knocking on doors and go door to door and asking for some money. So the gold is really big, and the minerals are out there, and they're digging it up, and we need to see some return on that. I'd like to thank my host family, Shelley Pinnell out of Dawson. She's been hosting me for like 20 years. The Brian and Marguerite Kitchen family. They've been doing it for about 10 or 12 years. They just won that energy fuel-efficient deal and won a brand-new vehicle for the whole Canada. And their family is real efficient on water and resources and stuff that they won that award. So I congratulate them for winning that also. My handlers, Lee and Nina, did a great job getting my team out of Dawson. And a lot of time on the trail, picking up my garbage behind there. So I'd like to thank them. Nina was the first year, and she did a great job. And Lee's been around for me for a while, and he supervised and made sure Nina did a well job, and they both did well. Congratulate them. And I'll see you next year.
Thanks, Dave Felton. And bib number two, brought to you by the Braeburn Lodge. How about those Cinnabons? Incredible. In ninth place, Christy Barrington, 50.
I wish I had a fun and interesting story to tell, but I don't. The table, they just make some stuff up, but I won't. Across the minute, say like, yeah, Anna and I switched three times and nobody noticed, but I didn't. And I thought, oh, well, we're microchips just like the dogs are, but no, that's not true either. So I have nothing interesting to say other than I had a great time and everything was just unbelievably great. And I thank the volunteers for putting up with all of us and all our dogs and all our nonsense so we could go out there and have fun and play and have an adventure. And the veterinarians were just amazing, making sure that we took good care of our dogs and that they had just as much fun as we did. I want to thank Paul for all the love and support and the great dog team, and thank the dogs as well because they brought me all the way here. I want to thank my sister Anna. It was so good to see her in Braeburn. I knew that she was going to be in Whitehorse, but it was just a surprise to turn around and see her there. So that was a real morale booster because I knew we were going to make it. And she just, her smiling face always makes me feel better. My handlers, they did a great job. I know they're at each other's throats at one time during the race, but they made it all the way back home, so that's good. All my fellow mushers out there, it's so amazing. Everybody, I ran out of pins for my runner plastic. I kept carrying them off, and I got some more there. I got some carbide tips for my brake. Everybody was just so helpful and just, oh, hey, you know, heads up on this on the trail up there, and just amazing how much we all help each other, even though we're competitors. I just feel so fortunate to be part of the family of mushers that we are. And finally, for my sponsors, I'm Northern Outfitters, Stanley Chrysler, Momentum Dog Food, No Room for Error Gear, Sherry Lassar, who I could not do this at all if she didn't help me. I love her to death. Nikki's Custom Sewing and Grabber Hand Warmers and Foot Warmers. And anybody that I forgot, I'm so sorry. And I just remembered here, Jim and Lee, thank you so much for hosting me up here and giving me someplace to stay. And for my dogs, you were so comfortable and happy there, and it was nice to talk dogs and have dinner with you guys. It was just amazing that you could take care of all four of us right when we came here to Whitehorse. And to David Munson and his family for putting me up in Fairbanks. It was very great that I could run dogs out of there and be comfortable and happy before the start of the big race. So thank you to everybody, and I'm glad we all had a fun and safe race.
Thank you, Christy. And bib number 21 brought to you by Sam and Andy's. And, boy, Abby threw a real curveball at us. We were watching the tracker late at night thinking, oh, yeah, we've got time to sleep. Yeah, no, she was whizzing down that trail. Number in eighth place, bib number 21, Abby West. Abby, come on up.
Hi. I would rather, no offense, be going over every single one of those glaciers we went on between Two Rivers and 101 and Central with a 20-dog team than be up here talking to you right now. Sorry. But I'll try. Ironically enough, I'm going to talk about something that really was the last thing that I wanted my race to be about. I had a rough winter. It was all mostly people-related. I wanted nothing to do but get out on the trail away from everyone in the world and just be with my dogs. There was a point in the race that I thought I was going to be competitive, and then I realized that my goals were unrealistic, and then it was all just about me and my dogs. So for this race, it was just about me and my dogs, even at the finish line where we were just there, me and my dogs. It's okay. It was actually the best finish ever just because of them. I'm going to talk about something else. Y'all know I worked for the Quest, or some of you don't. I worked for the Quest last year. One of the last things I did before I left was we were tossing around ideas for our poster this year. And Iris Wood, she's a really great musher and great artist, brought us this idea. And it was this really vibrant picture of some dogs running towards this, you know, the person that's looking at the picture. And we loved the style, and we loved her her just concept, which is still displayed in the poster now. But we wanted to tweak it a little bit, and I think it was maybe an idea of Marie or someone in Whitehorse that we really wanted to include the people in that poster. Because even though this race is all about dogs, and we all know that, and that's the most important thing for most of our lives, it's also about all these people. Now, I thought about this on top of King Solomon's Dome. I was going up there, and Zach, he's a pilot, was flying around a Japanese photographer, and of course it was the photo shoot of this really cool, beautiful sun, and here's this musher in her bright blue parka on top of this mountain, and I'm sure it was awesome. And I was thinking up there,
how random a girl from New Jersey is on top of a mountain and a guy from Alaska is flying around a guy from Japan, and here we all are in this place in the middle of nowhere. And you know what? That's because of our dogs. Our dogs give us, you know, strength and confidence, and they give us all these things, adventure, they give us debt. They also give us each other. They bring us all together. It's just like them. They're a pack. They're a team. And just like that, we all are a pack now, and we're all a team. We have vets from Australia. We have volunteers from who knows where. We got people winning races from Chicago. It's just why else would we be together but because of these dogs? It's just another amazing thing that they do. Now, you all might think I'm crazy right now, but I think in celebration of this, being that now we're a big pack, that we should all howl together right now. So, everybody all together now. Thanks to all you people out there. Thanks to all you people out there that really made this possible, but I really have to bring it back to the dogs. Thanks to my dogs, I cannot believe how many ways they amaze me, and I just can't get over it. I can't wait. I just miss them already. Anyways, see you next year.
And bit number three, brought to you by Canada Flooring Enterprises. Yeah, he's not a stranger. He's a veteran, although you think about it, some guys don't like to be called veterans, but he's been around forever. The seventh place, Sonny Lindner. Sonny, come on up.
Well, I, along with everyone else, I'd like to thank everyone that put this race on. And when I came into town, I was driving a pretty small team, and I was talking to Alan, and he goes, "Isn't that pretty tough, just having six dogs?" And I told him that, well, I had one eye getting kind of tired, and I found out if I squinted a little bit, I'd see double. And once I had 12 dogs, I was moving along pretty good. Thank you.
And bib number 17, brought to you by Bear's Paw Quilts. And here's a guy that came all the way from Norway. And I remember talking to him in the dog area right around Dawson. I asked him, "Hey, how is Rosebud? How is that incline?" He said, "Pretty easy." Really? Yeah. Dogs were barking all the way. So I don't know what they're drinking or what they're eating in Norway, but boy, let's welcome Joar Lesseth Olsen to the podium here tonight. I'd like to call upon Ruth Headley as well from Bear Paws Quilts. Ruth, if you just come by and stand stage left. Thank you.
I just want to thank everyone for putting on a good race. I had a lot of fun. I learned a lot from the other mushers, and they gave me a lot of advice. I want to thank the team Beringia, Camilla Porcel, my handlers, Geir and Larva. They did awesome. Thanks.
And we have a special presentation for Joar for coming all the way. We have got Ruth Headley from Bear's Paw Quilts. Ruth, come on over. And this is a special gift, is it?
Yes. As a small business, it's pretty risky buying a finishing bib because you never know what you're going to get, whether you're going to get your money's worth. But I got it with him. And so... when I read his bio and he said, 24, young man, young team, never done a long distance, my heart plummeted. But my staff and my customers, he became our guy. How's our guy? And so I'd like to give him this quilt to take home, and it's a trip around the world, which is what he had to make to get here. So, thank you.
And bid number 10, brought to you by Hurlburt Enterprises. No stranger to the quest, and he's one of those guys that is very personable, and he's great for the sport. Please welcome, in fifth place, Frank Sass.
Whew, another wild one out there this year, huh? Thanks, Hugh and Alan. Couldn't see it. Wish I was there to witness it with you. But one of these years, I'll be there to witness it with you. I just got to thank my sponsors. I've got a huge list, but I got to thank them all. My sponsor back in Fairbanks, New Haven Communities, Manscaped, Ryan Hughes, big good friend of mine, doing a lot of sponsors for me this year. Len Lees, Dog Paddle Designs, Cody, amazing sled. He was a little bit sketched out that I was going to use a pretty small sled that he built about, I don't know, a month and a half ago. And I rode it once and said, this is my quest sled. This is the only sled I'm ever going to drive again. So if you're looking for a sled, Dog Paddle Designs, he makes awesome sleds. My parents, Sass Construction, my mom and dad, I wouldn't be here without them. They support me in every way they can. My dad got both of my trucks over the race course this year, put tons of time and effort into it before the race. So big thanks to him out there. He drives computers. They sponsor my booties every year. Carol Davis Thermals. I wear this one-piece suit underneath everything that I wear that keeps me warm, warmer than anything before. This year, you didn't really need anything since it was so warm. But my handlers, Captain Steve Stoller. This is his third year with us, or fourth year maybe, around Wild and Free. And couldn't do it without him. He's the guy that gets the truck from point A to point B. Tom Walker, one of my best buds, he was out there helping me all the way, which I really appreciate. He also was the checkpoint manager at the Two Rivers checkpoint, so big thanks to him because that was an awesome checkpoint this year. Rose came along and did all of our Facebook updates. I know all my Wild and Free fans really appreciated that. The sport is all about getting out to the fans, and we were able to do that on our webpage there. Couple other people. When I came into Dawson, Tom says, Mike and Christine are down in the dog yard waiting for you. And I said, Mike and Christine, who the hell are they? I don't know who they are, you know. And he's like, Mike Ellis. And I had heard just a little ways back that Mike had fallen down and dislocated his shoulder. And I was really surprised to hear that he was in Dawson and ready to be there to help me take care of my dogs. And I could not have been. I left Dawson with 14 dogs on the break. As hard as I could. It was amazing. It was because him and his friend Christine, who came up from Lower 48, they couldn't put their effort into his awesome dog because he dislocated his shoulder, but they came and helped me out so much in Dawson. So Christine is here tonight. I can't thank you enough. And Mike had to go home. Everyone, just if you ever seen Mike, just he's an awesome guy for the sport, and I'm just so glad that he was out there to help me, and I hope next year he's back out on the trail himself. Kyla, of course, we all know who Kyla is. I wouldn't be here without her. She kind of picks up the pieces as I run around all season and while at the same time trains her own dog team to run this race. So, can't thank her enough. Matt and Mandy, who helped her the whole way. Okay. Volunteers, we would not be here without you guys. I started as a volunteer. I have the utmost respect for you. There's thousands of you out there and we can't, this race wouldn't happen without you. So thanks so much for that. All the vets, I had a really good time with you guys, especially Greg from Minnesota. He's come back multiple times, and it's really awesome to see someone who can be like, hey, I remember your dogs from the years past, and it really means a lot to me out there on the trail. Also, I got a quick story I got to tell you. He came up to me the other day, and he had bought a Wild and Free hat, and he said, I went to put it on and went and looked in the mirror, and he said, had to take it off because if he wore it around, everyone would think it was my dad because he looked exactly like my dad. So go back to Minnesota and wear that Wild and Free hat proudly. All the vets, all the officials, everyone at Stepping Stone, Scroggy, McCaig Creek, all the checkpoints, Sebastian at 40 Mile, that's what makes this race awesome. All these stops, all these places out there that we can take a break, chat, have a good meal. We wouldn't be here without those people. The Trail Breakers, again, awesome job. Josh Horst, my real good buddy, who he-hawed about taking this job over the last few, over the months leading up to the race. And in the end, I think we're all very, very fortunate that Josh took this job because it was a flawless race. So big thanks to Josh Horst for putting on an awesome race. The media crew, Mark, Tom, Scott, Ariel, amazing. It's the only word for it. I mean, the Quest is going to be so much better for all the work you guys did out there. Your movies are going to make the Quest just have amazing views on YouTube and Facebook and everywhere else. Let's see here. I got a couple other things. Yeah, I could go on all night. My dogs. I mean, there's no words to describe how awesome they were out there. It was a young group of dogs. Most of them are out of my main guy. Most of you guys know who he is, Silver. I didn't have Silver out there this year, and trust me, there were times where I was talking to my tattoo on the side going, "Where are you, buddy? I could really use you right now," you know. But they all pulled through, and I just want to tell one story. I was in Pelly, and I was having some troubles, you know. I was getting pretty down. I was pretty sleep deprived. Mike Ellis again was there and really helped me through that time. But I just had a good conversation with Mike as I left. I said, "I just need somebody to step it up. I just need somebody to step it up and lead us out of here and get us down the trail." And I went down the trail a ways and was moving stuff around. And I took this big dog, Merc. It's the son of Silver. He looked exactly like Silver. He always runs in the wheel. He never really liked the leader position, but he had pulled so hard all race. And I said, "I'm just going to give you a shot." I put Merc up there. He led for the next 200 miles of the race on and off. And really got my team down the trail and gave us that boost when we really needed it. So the best part is he looked exactly like Silver, so I could just imagine that Silver was up there the whole time when I was going on the trail with him. So, all right, I'm done. Thank you so much to everyone out there, and we'll see you next year. Have a good night.
Thank you, Brent. And as you know, Marcel Fresno is in Braeburn right now. We just received word that Michael Templin has just arrived in Braeburn as well. All is good. They have a mandatory 8-hour layover, and then it's full speed ahead to Whitehorse. Hans made an estimate of about 6 o'clock tomorrow night. We'll see what happens, depending on speed and conditions, of course. As we carry on with the program, by the way, we have prizes later on, but don't take off as soon as we get to our number one finisher. We've got stuff here for you. In fourth place, bib number 13, it's Icy Waters Limited being the sponsor. Thank you so much for that. In fourth place, from Big Lake, Alaska, please welcome Jake Berkowitz.
Well, thank you guys all for being out here tonight. A few thank yous. I don't have a big list or anything. To our major sponsor, dogbuddies.com, just helping the dogs get down the trail healthily and happily. That's what we're all here about. And for all you guys to take nice pictures of our shiny pink booties. A few other thank yous to my incredible handling crew, Jay and Robin. They were there every time, ready to help and aid for the dogs that I dropped. And a big thank you to all the spouses and partners and girlfriends out there. We're going to do something a little different. If everyone out there that was a spouse or partner or handler, if you guys could just stand so everyone in the room could recognize you, because with the Quest, you guys are so important to us. So if you guys could all stand so we can give you a little recognition, that would be really great. And then finally, we have our handlers, but most importantly, our dog team. We spend so much time with our dogs out there. And, you know, during the training season, we always say the dogs are doing what we want them to do. We're training them for these races. And once we get into these races, we're doing what the dogs need to do. We're taking the time to take care of them like we do all year long. And for these dogs to perform the way that they are, they're truly incredible animals, and they really deserve all our respect and all our praise, because they're the ones that really get us here. You know, we stand on the back of the fight and we tough some stuff out, but those dogs are pretty incredible. So thank you to all our dogs.
I should also mention that Jake is Rookie of the Year. Rookie of the Year, the first rookie to come across the finish line, first place rookie. Congratulations. Now we're in the top three, bib number 16, brought to you by Sewanee Freight Lines. Third place, You might have heard this guy before. Lance Mackey. Lance, come on up.
That's great. Now I have nothing to say now. Oh, it's nice to be back to Yukon Quest. I absolutely love this race, but people ask me if I was disappointed in missing last year, and I politely said no because I can't swim. So that was a good enough reason for me not to be here last year, but I missed the hell out of it, and I wouldn't have missed it again for as long as I could possibly stand it. So, but, you know, there's a lot of great memories of the Quest over the years, but this year tops a few of my lists of firsts, and you know, I was asked at the finish line if I could repeat some of those firsts, and a couple of them came to the top of my mind right at the finish line, but one that will never go away. I did Rosebud twice this year, because apparently I wasn't good enough at it the first time. I got about midway up, realized, well, I didn't know at the time, but I'd lost my runner plastic, and I got to the middle of the steep incline, and there's no snow, and my sled basically stuck to the side of the mountain like Velcro, and there was no moving, and I'd give the command to go, and we'd go 20 feet, and they'd look back at me like, get off the sled, Dad, helps out. So I was pushing for everything I had, and we wasn't going anywhere. Mike Ellis happened to be behind me, stopped waiting for me to get up over the hill so he could go, and my dog saw him down there and decided that that was a better spot to go than where we was trying to go. So I ended up in the back of my sled, laying there like a toothpick across the runners, and just freewheeling down the side of Rosebud. And for anybody that's ever seen Rosebud, it's not well, it's a hell of a ride, I'll tell you that. So that was just like the first of my many firsts. But a few that come to mind that I thought I'd share with everybody. And, you know, I've done this race six times, and ever since I started, I had a little mascot with me, a dog named Pebbles. And most of you have all seen her. I'm just a little, probably the ugliest dog in the world, but to me, she's my pride and joy. And I look forward to seeing her at every checkpoint with my wife. And this year was the first time they weren't there, so I was always kind of looking for my little dog. So I can't wait to get home and see her. But on that note, Tamara, she stepped up, you know, been good friends of our family for a long time. And I didn't have a handler this year. I called and found my buddy Brian. Actually, I didn't call anybody. I called my dad, told him what was going on, and he said, I'll help you. And he put me in touch with Brian. Brian used to have a dog team 100 years ago, and he moved way out of the way of snow and cold to kind of forget about dogs and being cold and miserable. And my dad reminded him of how much fun we have. So Brian, before he even hesitated, or before he even thought about it, he's like, yeah, I'll go. It was, 70 above the day he left to 51 below when he showed up at the Fairbanks Airport. And, I mean, he didn't even get his bags off the conveyor belt, and he was putting extra clothes on, you know. So I thank Brian for stepping up and driving and just giving a smile and not complaining too much about it. I definitely appreciate that. Thanks. Obviously, the Quest is known for cold weather, but this is the first time I've ever seen it above 20 below. So myself, I'm a little beat up, so I was pretty happy to see that. Unfortunately, the dogs suffered a little bit because of it. We trained in Fairbanks where it's 50 below. So another thing that kind of I'll never forget, I'm not even going to mention the team, but I passed the team while dragging on my side. And I looked up at the team as I went by, and I'm like, sorry, I can't help you. They're like, no, I'm sorry, I can't help you. I felt a little bit helpless at that moment, but we recovered. That was the first time I ever had a sit-down sled. And I don't know what the hell took me so long to get one. Man, this was a fun race. I had plenty of energy when I needed it, and I was drinking tea and eating turkeys in between checkpoints, and, you know, just having a great old time. And, yeah, like I said, I'm slow learning in some departments, apparently. The first time that I haven't heard about, I had no truck problems. That's a first. That's an absolute first. So I don't know what you did, Brian, but thanks for taking care of my truck. It's the first time that I actually followed Hugh Neff for 1,000 miles instead of Hugh following me for 1,000 miles. It was fun, buddy. I'm proud as hell of you, and it was fun to watch that team excel. And, you know, watching the race in the front there, I was just proud to be a part of it a little bit. But I can't help but beat on my buddy Hugh a little bit because, well, it's been back and forth for years, and I can honestly say this is the first Yukon Quest that I got to run so much with him that I wasn't finally penalized. Thank you. Great race, man.
And here we come to the very top. Deb number one, brought to you by Arctic Tulip Bookkeeping. Thank you, Arctic Tulip. They came out with muffins at the finish line for all volunteers. They're great people. Thank you so much. In second place, but really, you know, within 26 seconds, so how do we... It's Alan Moore. Alan, come on up.
Well, I'm not that much of a talker, but I know I knew he was going to help me out shortly. But it was a fantastic race. Hugh and I, we were at each other's throat, as was Lance, for most of the race. It was a good race till 995 miles into the race. That's when I saw his little light behind me, and things changed. And then it was really a race which... either one of us could have won it numerous times, even probably within a mile or two of the finish where we encountered some glare eyes, and I'm right behind him. He's already passed me, and his dogs thought they didn't want to go on glare eyes, so they take a sharp G or right and go up the side of the bank. So I said to myself, well, wow, here's another opportunity right here. All I have to do is say haw, go by, and I win. Well, mine did the same thing his did. Followed him right up the bank. So, actually, that's the way it was the whole race. We were just nip and tuck. So it was really exciting for us, and hopefully it was really exciting for you, and hopefully we can do it again. So I do have to thank a few people, of course. Let's see. We want to thank Frank Turner. He let us leave some stuff at his house, dog boxes, this, that, and the other. Dave Dalton lent us a harness so that we could finish the race. We had a dog that had harness rubs earlier in the race, so we used his harness. And actually, that dog, this is from Dawson, finished the race with one of his harnesses. So that was great. Thanks, Dave. And then we got some sponsors, Horizon Lines, Eagle Pack, Northern Outfitters. We got a few handlers. We got the ones I call the W's, Wes and Wendy, which are still here and going to help me drive back tomorrow. I'd like to thank them because they've been awesome, helped me in every way possible. Ray Crow, he's been our main handler the whole time. He's a great person to be a handler. And my wife, which is not here, she's home preparing for Iditarod. I'd like to thank her. And that's about it. Hopefully... we can come back again next year and try to make up that. How many seconds? I don't want to think about it. Thanks.
And we've got a special second place award as well. Reminder, we've got prizes we're going to be giving away, so don't dart after we get to the end. We've got stuff for you, so hang in there. Bib number six, brought to you by Summit Customs Brokers. First place, let's hear it for... All right. Hugh Neff.
Sober up, Whitehorse. Where to start? Start with my good buddy, Mr. Alan Moore. We're at the Meet the Mushers. We're all sitting at the table in alphabetical order. And it goes Lance Mackey, Alan Moore, Hugh Neff. Think about that. Then Alan looks over at me and he goes, I had a beer tonight, and it tasted good. Alan hadn't drank in a while, so I had one with him. But what he also said stuck in my mind the whole race. He said, wouldn't it be cool if we were all within an hour of each other coming into Whitehorse? So he's a bit of a shaman, I guess. But Alan and Lance, myself, Jake Berkowitz, the whole front pack, Brent, the beauty of these races is we're racing against each other, but we're racing with each other, too. And we all have our time, as Lance likes to say. And mine took a little bit longer than yours, brother, but I didn't grow up Dick Mackey's son. before I get into a little bit of other stuff, I just got to name a few sponsors. Northcutt Earl's camera will get on me. And by the way, before I say anything, can I get a big round of applause for Tamara? Because without her, I wouldn't be here, and we all know that. So North Petro Marine is the sponsor. The El Dorado up in Dawson. Red Paw Dog Food. Mountain Ridge. I'm going to miss somebody and get in trouble. Oh, NEA of Alaska. I don't know if you heard of them, but as many of you know, I do 50 relief schools a year. And they call me the Cat in the Hat, and I carry the book around to promote reading and literacy because that's what got me to the North when I was a city boy back in Chicago, sneaking into my dad's library and stealing books. And I didn't really read the Cat in the Hat, though. I was a little bit older than that, but I had James Michener and that fella Robert Service and Jack London and whoever else I could find. You know, my life is a book. It's a really weird one, too. So before I get into a few other things, I just want to tell you a little bit about my race because, you know, I don't look at it as a race. I look at this as like an adventure of another planet almost. I mean, a lot of people follow us on the internet and see some of our clips, but when we're out there, we're almost in an alternate universe when we're out on the trail, and I saw a lot of just amazing, amazing sights. I don't know what your religions are, what you believe in, but I definitely am a big believer in the spirit of the North, and I don't really go to church that much anymore unless somebody's, you know, something's happening, an event or what have you, but I don't really need to pray to God. You know why? Because when I'm out on the trail, I talk to God. And depending on, you know, your image of the Creator, I see it in just the land, the people, coming down Birch Creek. I remember vividly looking up at the clouds, and there was Carl Cochran looking down at me. And it was just one of the most amazing sights I've ever seen. And spirits are what makes the North. And it was just, I can't describe how many times in the race this year I just felt like a tingle, like I was being washed or something. You know, it could have been Alan Moore or something, but I do. Sometimes you feel some very strange, you know, I don't know how to describe it, but I'm touched in the head. You all know that, though. So as far as the race goes, not many people know this. I'm not even sure if he knows this, but one of my greatest mushing heroes besides Mr. Sonny Linder is a fellow named Mackie. And actually, his name is he's a Quest champion. His name is Rick Mackie. And as I got about a mile outside of the starting line, there was Mr. Rick Mackie. And he came up to me as my team's going by. A guy that I, you know, really respect a lot. I actually traveled 1 year on the trail with him and Timmy Osmar. And he goes, "Hey, my brother says you're a wimp and you're never going to beat him." And I knew he was just making it up and, you know, teasing me a little bit, but boy, was that good motivation. as far as moving down the trail, so many amazing sights and friendly faces, and that's why I'm always trying to stay positive. And you know, as far as the penalties and all that sort of stuff, you know, I'm the Cat in the Hat. The Cat in the Hat is supposed to get in trouble and try to fix his messes up. And so, you know, an axe not being at the bag for a while, I knew it would be an obstacle to overcome, but, you know, in life we all have challenges that we have to figure out how to make the best of. And that being said, I hold, you know, all responsibility for what happened there. And my buddy Jaime from Hawaii and Bruce from Spokane, you guys were the best handlers I could ever have imagined this year, and what you did out there. And Tamara helped out a lot, and Dawson as well. And speaking of Dawson City, there's a few reasons why I won this race. One was because Lance helped me out with I had a little bit of diarrhea on my team one day, and within a couple hours, it was cleaned up. Like, it was a miracle, really. And from then on, we were rocking and rolling. But the other person or people that really helped me out, it was interesting that they appeared. I didn't even really know they were in the race, to tell you the truth. But growing up, you know, I read a lot of books about mushing, and my mushing heroes weren't really quest or Iditarod mushers. They were explorers, you know. Shackleton and Scott and Amundsen was a big hero of mine. And so when I pull into Dawson to get my vet check, all of a sudden I have two veterinarians that walk over with these, you know, fairly thick accents. And it was Hannah and Pear. I had no clue who these people were. But they obviously knew what they were doing because they basically started teaching me how to run my dogs. And she just sat there and laid down on the straw and started describing how I should feed them and what I need to do to take care of them. And it was an amazing moment in my life. And this race, out of all the races, to be quite honest, I learned the most. And maybe that helped at the end. The beauty of Hugh Neff is, you know, this is my 20th 1,000-mile race. So I've been pretty busy, but I'm the eternal Chichaco. I don't want to get old, you know. My grandparents were named Daddy Herbert and Mama Dixie, and we weren't allowed to call them Grandpa and Grandma because they didn't believe in getting older. They just believed in getting stronger, and that's what I'm hoping to do. Lance is the same way. Hopefully every musher in this room is that you want to run dogs for the rest of your life, because when you're out there, you're wild and free, baby. Hey, Brent? Coolest part of this race, leaving Dawson, not very cool. Got a little turned around on the trail, had Walter up there, and Wally baby said, I want to go back to the campground and have a few more Z's and another chicken. But unfortunately, we got wrapped around a canoe, and it was lovely. I'm wrapped around a canoe. There's like a couple hundred people up there cheering me on. Go, Hugh, go. But I figured that out. And the funniest part about that was Sebastian, you know, who's like a half-brother of mine, he's there right next to me taking pictures of me being a huge mess again. So that was quite a moment in time. But Sebastian, it was fun having Sebastian out here. And I know a lot of you guys read his stuff during the race. And he's a great person for the sport and for the quest. But the cool part after Dawson was it just got dark on the other side of King Solomon's Dome. And you're going through the mining district, and there's a lot of tracks everywhere. So I always get a little spooked in that area because I figure there's a lot of game and it can get dangerous. So what I did was this year I did a little Jeff King thing that he did, but he plays country music, and I like all types of music, but certain music I like better because I am from Chicago. So I got my iPod, and I have it hooked up to a little speaker that I put on top of the sled, and I was actually going through the Dawson Mining District listening to B.B. King for about an hour play the blues. And it is a moment that I will always treasure, and it was heaven. And it took me a while to catch you, Mackie, though. I can't believe you camped up there. I mean, he's camped up on the top of the Black Hills in a windstorm with Alan. And I'm like, sorry, fellas, I'm going to William's place over at Scroggy. That's a little bit more comfy. But as far as, what Alan and I went through, it was so much fun. And I really, at the time, whether I won or lost, you know, for me, it's all about the journey more than anything. And I'm still a little bit stunned that I'm up here, you know, getting this award and all that. But we gave it our all. And we gave it our all not just because we wanted to win, but we wanted to do our best for all of you. So when I'm out there racing, I ain't racing because I want to win this award or, you know, be the next champion. I'm doing it because I have a lot of
friends in all the native villages that I've lived in that were, you know, I don't know if they'd let me back in the village if I'd blown this one. I just left it all out there, and I think we all know the reason I really left it out there, and that was for Geronimo. So it does feel good, doesn't it? Thank you very much.
You now. Thank you. We've got the special awards presentation right now. We're going to bring up Hans Otley and head veterinarian Kathleen McGill to present the special awards along with Sue Thomas. And before we do that, we've got the commissioner of the Yukon, Mr. Doug Phillips. Arcticus parka, in case you're not aware, I wore mine in Alaska, and people come up and want to get pictures with you because it's the authentic parka of the North. On behalf of Coca-Cola and Canada Goose Arctic Program, the red jacket for Mr. Huneff.
First place, who also receives this lovely print. And it is the Yukon Crest logo, Yukon Crest print.
So, like, the coolest part about having this red jacket is that I am now more like my friend Sebastian. No, they don't get enough, I think we all really need to step it up for Canada Goose and for, you know, I love Coca-Cola. It's a great, great drink. Alone or with something else, you know. But Lance has taught me a lot of things over the years. Thank you.
We're going to put Hugh to work tonight. He's going to draw the winning ticket from the 50-50 draw. So get your 50-50s out.
What if I think I saw?
You got your ticket? Conflict of interest? One ticket. You can read the number.
Just the last ones or all of them?
Read all of them.
All right. 7, 9, 8, 5, 9, 0. Nice. You know the guy?
It looks like it's Park LaPrairie, who coincidentally is also a board member with the Yukon Quest. he's also our treasurer. And I believe what I'm understanding is Clark is donating his winnings to the Yukon Crest. Thank you, Clark.
And if you're following along in Johnson City, the first person to hit the checkpoint would pick up 4 ounces of plaster gold. And this time around, by the way, you had to finish the race to qualify for this gold award. Dawson Award goes to Mr. Alan Moore.
where the gold has been hidden all night. I'm going to get in trouble with Allie for this, I'm sure. There you go.
Could I fill it one more time, Sue? All day long, she's kind of been teasing me with it. So here the last few hours, I would say, can I fill it, Sue? She said, no, no, my husband's here. So anyway, I would like to thank Joe and Wendy Fellers for donating this goal. It means a lot to every musher every year that they do win this. So we just appreciate them, and that's why this quest is what it is. It's for these people that are donating this type of stuff. So thank you. That's a lot.
And we mentioned the Rookie of the Year earlier, but Jake Berkowitz, come on up. Rookie of the Year for the Quest 2012. The first rookie to cross the finish line.
I guess this award, it means a lot in this race. Being a rookie is definitely being a rookie. It's definitely an advantage being a veteran in this race. And I guess I'd really like just to thank all the veterans. Hugh and Alan and Lance and Brent and Sonny were a huge help in this race. I hope I felt as a competitor to them, but they really just treated all of us as friends out there. They gave me a lot of information about the trail. When we're pushing this hard and doing these long runs, you really need to have all your ducks in a row, and these guys really made sure that I knew what I was getting myself into. So a big thank you to all the competitors out there.
Thank you, Jake. And Hans has more on the Challenge of the North.
The Challenge of the North is voted by the judges and the race marshal, and it was sort of a little bit of a tough decision this year, and it amplifies the overcome of every obstacles out there and what we stand for in the North and how we travel and uphold our utmost survival skills and so on. We came to the conclusion that the guy that's unfortunately still out there fighting his way into Whitehorse in last place probably, Michael Talbin, should get it. And that beautiful glass ornament will be his.
We can call up Dr. Kathleen McGill with the best choice.
This is something that I talked to the vets at the beginning of the race. Not all of us get to see all the teams all the way along the trail, so we have to put our heads together. And sometimes it's very difficult. The care is so good along the trail. Other times, we really have to think about it. But this year, it wasn't hard to think about it. Let me tell you what the Vets' Choice Award is and how we think about it as vets. It has to do with care, conditioning, and competitiveness. So they need to finish in the top 10, because it is, after all, a sled dog race. And we want to make sure in that race that if you take care of your dogs, you'll get to the end. I'll just read you a short paragraph of a very long list of things that we look for in teams. But what the purpose of the Vets' Choice Award is to recognize the individual who best exemplifies how optimal animal care translates into top conditioning, which leads to the highest level of competitiveness, and in other words, the humane treatment of the racing sled dog and winning a sled dog race are not mutually exclusive, but rather intimately linked. And I think we've seen that every year on the Quest. We've seen it this year again. My vets have voted for Christy Barrington.
Christine wins $1,000 of animal care at a local veterinarian.
I don't know what to say. I didn't even think it was possible for a rookie to win this award. I'm sorry. I couldn't have done it without the veterinarian team. They were amazing. I'm sorry. I'm just blown away.
I'll say it for her. We were real proud of the way Christy took care of her dogs. Anything we had in the way of constructive criticism or help, she just immediately did it. Her dogs looked great the whole way down the trail. She did a great job.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
And I'll bring Hans up to explain the Red Lantern Award.
Well, we don't know yet. Well, we can assume, but I just explained what it is. Everybody, I guess, knows the Red Lantern Award goes to the last finisher. So by tomorrow, my guess will be 6 o'clock in the afternoon, we will know who out of the two last ducklings of mine out there will be it. Thank you.